Good morning, everyone. Thank you for joining our webinar. This webinar is aiming to answer a simple question: how to define new employee mobility patterns. Today, I have the pleasure to welcome Yael Benatan from the Arval Mobility Observatory. Hello, Yael.
Good morning, everyone. Thank you for inviting me.
Thank you, Yael. So this morning we actually had a lot of participation, a lot of interest raised by the audience. We have more than 500 registrations this morning, and we are extremely honored for your interest. So without further discussion, so let's start. So mobility trends are showing an accelerating drift to sustainability and flexibility. We believe that now it's the time to act. Sorry, we have an issue with the presentation. It will come shortly. So now it's the time to act for fleet managers, mobility managers, or HR managers to ensure that they have the right answer to support employee mobility needs. So just bear with us a second so the presentation can come back. Just a small technical issues. So while it's been fixed, so I will walk you through the agenda of this morning. So first, we will bring you a short introduction on the situation we have been currently living in the last 12 months. Then Yael will give a short update on the mobility trends. Those mobility trends have obviously a big impact on mobility stakeholders. And then we will see how we can respond to those impacts, including a very strong business case that will illustrate how we can minimize and also tackle those impact. So if you have any question in the course of this webinar, please do not hesitate to use the chat function in order to submit your questions, and we will take 15 minutes at the end of the session in order to respond to your questions. So is the presentation back on? So really sorry for this. Just bear with me. So as we said, now you can see the agenda. So much better for now. It's going to be easier to have this webinar. Sorry for those technical issues. So let's kick off with the introduction. I think we were in an unprecedented historical situation. I mean, in history, there's nothing which could be compared to what we have been living in the last 12 to 18 months. Just one shocking figure is that 50% of the population were in lockdown in at some point in 2020. We had also second wave that has finished. Now we see that the third wave is actually coming in with a third lockdown, for example, in the UK, as well as in Portugal, just to name those two countries. Experts are estimating that the economy will be back to pre-COVID levels in 2.5 years. And if we deep dive, for example, on the automotive industry, the car registration is at the lowest point since 25 years. And even more, if we take the example of France, just recently, we saw that the car registration were at the same level of 1975, so more than 45 years ago. From an employee standpoint, 99% of workers would like to work regularly from home. And if we compare with figures from 2018, it was at that time 5%. So we see a big boost of home working. Of course, lockdown were helping it. But what is important to remember is that we are living a time which no one who has lived so far has known before. Now, let's maybe deep dive on mobility trends, so specifically on mobility, to know what are those the impact of this COVID situation to mobility. So over to you, Yael.
Thank you, James. So, in fact, what we have to keep in mind is that all these mobility trends were already exist before the pandemic. So we had already the mega trend, the CASE paradigm, autonomous car, connectivity, electrification. We had already the urbanization issues, so congestion, air quality concern. We already seen before the pandemic, company car policy becoming company mobility policy. Home working was already existing. But in fact, what we can see is that the pandemic had an impact on a short-term period. So here we can see that that the perception regarding health safety of mobility trend is that private vehicle, private bike, walking, of course, appear as the most safe mobility modes, and shared mobility and public transport appeared as the more risky. So due to this fear of COVID-19 infection, in fact, we see that as a result of this fear of contamination, we see that in a, just after the lockdown, post-lockdown, we see a pronounced preference for driving that emerged as travelers were avoiding public transport, in fact, for sanitary reasons. And in fact, this pattern is seen in nearly all countries and across different data sources. So here you can see this impact. But this fear of contamination had also another impact at a really short term on public transport and shared mobility solution. In fact, private car, private bike, private e-scooter, own e-scooter and walking, of course, were the winners at the expense of the public transport. That the impact at short term. Within 12 or 18 months, public transport and shared mobility should recover thanks to the vaccination process. So this is the result of the BCG survey you can see on this screen. But in fact, even if these trends already existed before the pandemic, and if the pandemic has an impact on short term, we can also say that pandemic is an accelerator to sustainable and flexible mobility. In fact, after the first wave, the European unions have incorporated green policies in their recovery plan and have decided to implement a lot of investment in environmentally friendly solutions. So that's the first point. So from the public authorities, there was a real focus. It was already there, but it was accelerated by the pandemic, a real focus on sustainability topic. So from the European Commission, but also from the government, for example, the UK has decided to invest more than £2 billion to put cycling and walking at the heart of their transport policy. But all these decisions were also supported by economic stimuli. I mean a bike incentive, for example, in order to purchase bike. It was the case in France, but also in Italy. And also municipalities' actions regarding investment in infrastructure and urban planning. Indeed, a lot of cities such as Vienna, Paris, Brussels decided to turn roads into bike lanes. And of course, there was already a CSR focus, which was reinforced during the pandemic at companies' level. But also a change regarding the way of working. More work from home were experimented during this pandemic, so leading to less commuting. And of course, we see that there are more and more mobility modes available and used by the employees. But shared mobility solution, as we've seen on the previous screen, will recover in the coming months because it appears it's still a solution to avoid public transport. So all these challenges, all these changes have an impact for sure on decision maker, which is that there are more mobility mode, more work from home, leading to less commuting. So all these changes have an impact for a decision maker. Shems, could you please explain to us what are the impacts for these decision makers?
So indeed, with everything you explained, we see that the world has changed and the mobility patterns have changed. And obviously, it will have an impact for decision makers. So maybe let's deep dive on three types of stakeholders. So fleet manager, mobility manager, and HR managers. So if we look at the role of a fleet manager before the pandemic, it was mainly focused on controlling of the cost, managing and driving the transition to greener fleet, and initiating the shift towards mobility management. So from fleet management to mobility management. During the confinement, we all had this crisis to manage, and the real focus was to make sure that the fleet operations were still ongoing, to make sure that the employees who needed to be mobile could still be mobile in order to serve their customers. And after this confinement, where companies started to really adapt to this new normality, the focus of the fleet manager was to ensure that the contract terms with their leasing provider were aligned with the actual usage of their drivers, and also make available a more flexible solution in order to address the volatility in terms of usage of their employees. If we look at mobility managers, again, a focus on CSR and aligning their mobility policies to CSR. It was also their role to manage budget, of course. And during the confinement and the lockdown, they needed to review the strategy on shared mobility and public transport. At that time, the clarity on whether the shared mobility solution or public transport will have to be tackled differently. Do they need additional support to ensure the safety and the health of their employees with regards to this? What type of additional requirement they should ask to their suppliers? So many questions needed to be answered. end in this new normality. I think now it's fully part of the mobility manager's job to constantly assess the safety of those mobility needs and reviewing very regularly if the mobility needs, the mobility solutions available for their employees are still the right solution. Now, for the HR managers, mobility is of course, a mobility package as such, is of course a key lever to employee retention, and is also a key part of the CSR strategies of a company. Company Car, before the COVID-19 crisis, was of course the main lever for HR managers to retain employees with regards to mobility package. But after the pandemic and given the trends that Yael just described before, we see an increased needs for HR managers to include those alternative mobility solutions into their employee package, knowing also that new generations are more sensitive to this type of package rather than the traditional company car.
So thank you, Shams. So it's very interesting. So don't, to the audience, don't hesitate to ask your question. We will get back to you at the end of the presentation, but don't hesitate to ask your question. Just keep in mind that after this webinar, you will receive a link to have all details regarding this presentation, an executive summary with more details about that. So thank you, Shams. How can decision makers understand the new mobility patterns for their employees and be sure that they have the right employee offer?
This is the core of our presentation, and indeed we are convinced that this will be the main challenge for the coming years for mobility decision makers. At Arval, we have developed an approach called Arval Mobility Consulting. This approach is considering all aspects of mobility in a broader sense. So whatever the mode of transportation, whatever the types of trips, because we cannot exclude as well private mobility on top of business and commuting as we used to with only fleet management. And also considering the infrastructure in the surroundings of the premises of an employer. It could be the building accessibility, so the train station around, the bike lanes, etc., but also the parking management, electric charging point available around or even in the parking lot. So many of those aspects has to be considered to have the most tailored vision of what is possible. So the Arval Mobility Consulting approach is extremely straightforward. It's a three-step approach aiming to define and realize the ambition of our clients. So the first steps that we will, and we will deep dive the three steps a bit later. So the first step is aiming really to set the ambition and objective of our clients. Second step is to make a real diagnosis of the current situation to understand what are the current mobility practices. And the third one is the recommendations and solution design to answer, let's say, the gaps that we have identified in the diagnostic to reach the ambition of our clients. So let's deep dive on the first step. So ambition and objective setting. So here, in order to do that, so one said, well, a company knows what is its ambition, they knows what its objective, but are we sure that when we set this up as a company, that we are taking the right parameters into consideration. In order to support this and to ensure that we have the right objective and the right ambitions, we have a set of tools. First one is the client mobility profiling. It's a set of questions helping to understand what is the most important aspect of mobility for the employer, whether it's CSR, whether it's total cost of mobility, so the cost or making savings, or it's employee satisfaction, which will of course drive employee retention. And as you can see, by considering all those three parameters, we can answer the interest and the let's say the objectives of fleet manager, HR managers, and of course mobility managers. Once we have done that, we will have to assess if the current mobility policy can support the ambition that we will define. Of course, if there's no existing mobility policy, the car policy, company car policy, will be the starting point. And the final deliverable will be a mobility ambition charter, who will put clear objectives, a priority, and a time frame in order to give, let's say, the first frame of the program towards mobility shift. The second step is related to the diagnosis, and this is the core of this approach. Here, as we said earlier in the presentation, we really aim to understand what is those new mobility patterns. And we are using, again, a different set of tools. I will not detail all of them. You will have all details in the executive summary we will share later. But let me deep dive on what I believe is one of the most important, is the employee mobility analysis. The employee mobility analysis is essentially a mobility audit, where we will use either surveys or digital tools to understand what are the common use of mobility, whether employees are using public transport a lot, or they are using a mixture of public transport plus private transportation, and maybe shared mobility. And what is also extremely important is to understand where my employees are coming from. So if I'm based at the center of Paris, there's a high chance that my employees are coming from either the center of Paris or maybe in the suburbs, or even coming from other cities in France. So having that vision will support the fact to profile employees and making sure that for each profile of employees, we have the right offer. The main deliverable of this diagnosis is, as we explained, a NASIS analysis, and on top of that, a gap analysis. So a gap analysis will estimate what is missing to the current situation versus the ambition we have defined in the first steps. So extremely straightforward again, however supported by extremely advanced tools to have the best visibility on the employee pattern, mobility patterns. And the third solution is the solution design. So depending on the profile we have defined at the second stage, we would design usually with the client, so co-create a mobility offer for those employees, and of course give an update to a mobility policy, or even create a mobility policy as well as a mobility plan for the employees. The implementation and the recommendation can include Arval mobility solutions, and we have plenty across our territories, including car sharing, ride sharing, or even bike lease. But if it makes sense for employees, we can also recommend third-party solution, for example, free floating, ride hailing, etc., etc.
So thank you, Shem. So really clear, straight to the point, efficient. But how can we maximize the success of such a program?
Indeed. So as you said, it's extremely straightforward, but of course it needs a lot of focus at company level. It needs some, of course, time and resources to maximize the success. And we will go through some key success factors that we have identified in our past experience. One thing I didn't mention, by the way, is that the approach has been already trialed. We have tried this first with ourselves, so at Arval in the head office in France, and it allowed us to include several mobility solutions for our employees and available for everyone, but also with customers. And we will see a bit later a real business case with an international customers. So going back to the key success factors, I think the first let's say factor to ensure the success is real sponsorship from top management within the organization. The second one is to have a dedicated resources in your company, whether it will be the fleet manager, whether you have already a mobility manager, or even it could be HR. The point is to have someone to animate and to also sell internally this type of programs. Employees are, of course, key levers, and without employee buy-in, there's nothing much you can do. Given, let's say, the real popularity of those type of topics among the general public, I am extremely confident that employees will always support this type of initiatives, given the fact that it's extremely innovative, it's good for the brand image of your company, and also it's a real tool to retain the best employees. But if you look at a success factor from an external standpoint, we have seen, and we actually used it for ourselves, you can create real synergies with your neighbors. So if you are in an area where you have plenty of companies with their HQ there, you can, of course, work with them to see if you can influence public administration regarding the site accessibility, whether it could be additional parking lots, public parking spots, or creating a bike lane, or even a public charging point for EVs. It could be many things. The good thing is that if you have the weight of several companies representing X thousand of employees, you for sure have a real voice to the public administration. And we see that this is something who actually work. The last point is, of course, also to partner with public authorities, especially for public transportation, to improve the offer around your premises, whether to have additional trains, whether to create a bus line. And for example, as we did at Arval premises, have an autonomous vehicle making the shuttle between the train station and the Arval office. So this is real case, which can bring real value to your employees as well. Now, you cannot, of course, deliver this type of programs to shift towards mobility without having a strong business case as well, in a sense that companies are there to make profit, so it cannot be at all costs. You have smart ways to find good financing for those solutions. And let's deep dive to some of them. So we have defined four areas of potential ways to finance those mobility solutions. So we have external ones, internal, professionals, and also employee initiatives. So if, for example, we take the example of public subsidies, you can for sure, given the fact that all the governments are now trying to push for, let's say, more sustainable mobility of the population, they can provide subsidies, for example, for bikes, as we do in France, where people can get 500 euros if they buy an electric bike. So this is the type of public subsidies you can look for in order to finance your shift. Budget dedicated to legal obligation and compliancy. There's plenty of laws which have been let's say drafted and applied in many countries, especially in Europe, to let's say push and to drive the shift towards alternative mobility, alternative to cars, which provide or give a frame, for example, to mobility budget, which gives a frame also or additional incentive for the use of e-bikes. So plenty of possibilities. Of course, it's not homogeneous if we compare one country to another, but the trend is that they will go in that direction and provide more and more incentive for the population. The other thing also, as we said earlier, is that HR, CSR, and of course the fleet, but also the top management, have a real interest in have a successful mobility shift, and you can then pull some internal budget in order to sustain this or finance this type of programs. Now, if we look at a more if we take a more operational angle, and actually this is, I think, one of the most important levers to finance, and we will see that in the business case, is to optimize your current cost. So if we take the car or the fleet management cost, those could be further optimized and look for savings over there in order to finance the shift towards alternative mobility solution. And this is something which can work. You have a good reason for sure to let's say look for optimization and savings, and from an employee perspective, it's extremely easy to justify that. So even if, for example, you lower the level of car in the car policy, but on the other hand, you provide additional mobility solution to your employees, this can be a real let's say easy to ease this transition. And of course, you can work on the behavior of your employees for them to use rightfully and in the right way all those mobility solutions.
Okay, thank you, Shems. Could you please give us a concrete example of a successful mobility transition project?
Yes. So as I said earlier, we have trialed this solution and this approach with our clients, so with trusted clients, and I decided to take this example of an international client operating in IT, especially for their entity in France. So this company had one issue, is that first they were facing a change in their employee type, so younger people who were less interested in company car. Hence, they saw a huge increase of cash allowance request instead of company car orders. And it was a bit disturbing for the client, as it had a significant financial impact on their side. The other thing is that they had a real ambition to be innovative in their mobility offer, and they wanted to include in their mobility offer alternative solutions to car. So the objective were clear. First, increase the share of electric vehicle, introduce a new mobility solution, and transform their current company car policy into a broader mobility policy. And it actually, after a 9-month mission, extremely detailed and intense, but with a good involvement of the client itself, we managed to identify the savings from the fleet costs that we use to finance alternative mobility solution. We, on top of that, we were able to reduce significantly the benefit in kind for drivers by introducing electric models. So it was a good thing for the company because they were able to achieve their ambition cost neutral, so without additional cost, and for the employees having a significant reduction of their benefit in kind taxation. The approach that we have used is the one we have described, of course, earlier. But I wanted to deep dive on the diagnostic. The diagnostic was extremely detailed, and it was actually most of the mission was dedicated to this diagnostic, where we performed a survey, who allowed us to identify the profile within the employees, and we end up with three different types of profiles. We called one initial profile, so those are more the offer towards energy transition, towards employee who have no other choice to use a car, whether they are salespeople living in a less urban area, or it could be many other examples. But essentially, those were not able to use other mobility solutions than their company car. The only difference is that we pushed for electric vehicles for this population. Second profile was sort of a mixed profile. So those are type of population with a high interest on mobility, living in areas where you have mobility solution available, but still for job needs needed to have a dedicated car. Either for job needs, but also for private, because if they have a family, if they have a house in the countryside, they want to keep their company car, and we provide it for them. So this mixed profile was a combination of a dedicated company car sharing, and also ride sharing solutions for those employees. The last one was the most innovative one, so 100% towards mobility solutions, more urban type of population, usually younger. So for those type of population, we proposed electric car sharing, ride sharing, bike lease as well, and of course subsidies for public transportations. So really this solution allow employees to use the new mobility package, but still having this sustainable angle with clean and green mobility solutions.
Concretely, what are the advantages for the clients?
So the advantages for the clients are, I think, quite straightforward again. What is important to remember is that this offer really supports you in achieving your own ambition. What it means is that we will not manage those type of programs the same way for all the clients. It's impossible. Each client has his own let's say parameters as his own type of employees. And by design, this approach will be customized to the customer needs. The other thing which is important to remember is that it considers the three main parameters to ensure that your company ambitions are respected. So CSR, employee satisfaction, and cost. So why it is extremely important? Because you can have a very CSR oriented solution, but with a high cost. You can have a very CSR oriented solution with a cost neutral and also maintaining employee satisfaction. So the idea is just to find the right balance, but it's okay for a company to say, my main priority is the employee satisfaction, whatever the cost. It's also fine, and the approach can of course sustain and support this type of choice. For your benefit, so Arval Consulting is the consulting organization of Arval, present in 11 countries and able to operate in 28 countries. Who is able to let's say really take ownership of this type of programs for you. So it will be a single point of contract a single point of contact for you to manage this type of project, as well as you will benefit from our network of experts and partners, whether they are mobility solution provider or expert in the market, to really help you in this journey. As I said earlier, this approach can be tailored 100% to your needs. And of course, it's an end-to-end support. As part of Arval, we have the ability to support you from the definition of the needs to the activation of the mobility solution we would have identified together. So we have actually 2 minutes, we are 2 minutes in advance, Yael, despite the technical issues, but again, apologies for this. Maybe we could take the first questions.
Yeah, okay. So can you elaborate on the link between cost, CSR, and total cost of mobility?
So, as I said earlier, we can easily define any project depending on those three simple parameters: whether it's related to mobility, whether it's related to fleet management, CSR, cost, and employee satisfaction. As simple as that. CSR can be sometimes costly and can be also, let's say, decreasing the employee satisfaction. Same for the cost. If you are too, let's say, conservative on cost, you will not achieve your CSR ambition, and maybe the employee satisfaction will decrease. However, there's opportunities to have those three parameters fulfilled if you find the right balance. And this is why we let's say design all objectives and ambition with the clients with regards to those three parameters to ensure that the change will not have significant impact on what you do already good with your employees or within your companies.
Okay, thank you. In order to deep dive in this question, we have another question. How do you deal with country-specific tax schemes?
So, as I said, we have a team of let's say a team of consultants across 11 countries. So those, they are based in those 11 countries, and they are, of course, experts in the specificities of their own markets, whether it's Spain, Czech Republic, UK, etc., etc. With this strength, we are able, of course, to take all local specificities, including taxation, which is, of course, extremely complex, and mobility and fleet have a significant, let's say, link with the taxation. To answer the question, this is how we ensure that we are always fulfilling and optimizing the taxation landscape, because we have actually local experts in those countries.
Thank you, Shams. Another question, what are the triggers to actually introduce biking as a professional mode for companies?
Well, it could be many. So first, you need to have the will as a company to provide those innovative solutions to your employees. But if the question is around the real usage, so I cannot give you on top of my head, let's say, the real proportion. But what we look is that if, as a, for example, a company car eligible employee, you live less than 5 kilometers of your offices, and you have in your usage, even on weekend, a very low usage of your car, I think the business case is quite obvious. Having a bike, or even an electric bike if you are not a sporty guy, to commute to the office, and also to do whatever you do on weekend, since already before you were not using your company car. It's just a better use of the asset. However, as we saw in the example, if you are, let's say, a job need type of employee, we can always imagine to have a mixture of bike lease and car sharing when you actually need, or when you actually need a car, or if during the week you are using your car for work quite often, having still a dedicated car.
Okay, thank you. What tools are there to objectively recommend a specific mobility mix? I mean, what is the blender that gives us a specific mix? This is a question we just received.
So maybe can you repeat, but I'm not sure.
What tools are there to objectively recommend a specific mobility mix? And the person means, what is the blender that gives us a specific mix?
Okay, that's a good question. So when we do this diagnostic, if you remember in the second step, once we have defined those profile I was mentioning before, we really have a co-creation phase, I would say, with the client, because the client would always know better their employees. So data is one thing, but knowing exactly, you know, their employee is another thing. And we really have a discussion point by point with the client to really choose the right solution for clients. The job of the consultant and Arval Consulting is to make some recommendation, but then the fine tuning will be done along with our customers. So this is why we ensure or maximize, let's say, the success and acceptance of those recommendations.
Okay, thank you. Customer one contact, which functions are main leads? And does this impact the decision or timeline or speed?
Again, can you repeat, because I have some echo?
So customer one contact.
The customer one contact, okay.
Which functions are main leads? And does this impact the decision or timeline speed?
Okay, so having, as I said, having a dedicated resources within your organization is a key success factor. What we have seen so far is that you have, let's say, a nomination of a sort of project manager, whether it's fleet, HR, or CSR, but it doesn't mean that all the other functions do not take an active part in the project. And I would strongly recommend to make sure that all those functions and all the ones which are, let's say, relevant in your organization, stay in the project, even though you will have, let's say, someone leading. In terms of decision, usually for this type of project, the decision is taken anyway at the highest level of the organization. Does it change the let's say the final outcome? Possibly. However, having let's say an ownership spread and so participation of all the relevant functions within your organization will ensure that all the aspects are respected and the best solution is taken from the start for your employees and of course your companies. I hope it answered the questions.
Thank you, Shams. What about today's and future trends in tax, financial incentive, penalties to push new CSR compliant mobility approach?
Well, it's extremely hard to, let's say, to forecast. Huh? What is sure and what we see today is that the trend is towards sustainable mobility. You don't have at this stage, and we see as well on CompagnieCar, we don't have any government, let's say, doing everything they can to maintain a high CO2 emission level in their countries. They are doing everything they can, possibly in the frame of what is possible, to push, drive, incentive the use of sustainable mobility solution, whether it's electric car or bike.
And if I can add something, in December, and invite you to have a look on that, the European Commission has issued its new mobility strategy program. Let's have a look on this strategy and mobility strategy, because it's really focused on sustainability, on all this low carbon modality transport solutions. So I invite you to have a look on this new strategy published in December, which confirms exactly what Shams said. So depending on the country, depending on the also the municipalities, because some decisions are also taken at municipalities level, you have some incentive. You have so tax it's at government level for sure, but you have some different incentive regarding bikes, for example, at local level and at government level. But indeed, the focus is really on sustainability in the future. Next question.
Yes, please.
How would you see electric car usage across Europe? Would you find electrical cars easy to find and use?
Well, that's a very good question. Again, we see, of course, a different level of maturity across Europe and also across the world with regards to electric vehicle. First, in order to, let's say, have a successful introduction of electric vehicle and making electric vehicle more mainstream in a country, you need a combination of factors. You need first to have an OEM offer, which is responding and answering all different needs, including commercial vehicles as well, of course. You need to have a taxation landscape, and we were mentioning this taxation landscape in your country, which is incentivizing the use of electric vehicle. You need, and that's actually already the case, you need to have infrastructure which are let's say enough so enough infrastructure charging point in order to support the usage of electric vehicle. We see that the number of charging stations in Europe dramatically increased in the last few years. There's already some plan from a major European country to further improve that coverage. However, in some other countries in Europe, this has been a bit delayed, or the investment has not been done yet. However, again, the trend is towards launching and deploying a charging infrastructure. And of course, that's also a key lever to have energy transition. If we take the example of the Netherlands, for example, made all those factors available, and I could have mentioned Norway, but the Netherlands recently made all those factors available to really push for the adoption of electric vehicle. And now we see in some cases fleet totally electrified in, with some corporate clients. Norway is even more far more advanced than this. And more recently, UK, since last year, thanks to ambitious incentive, fiscal incentive towards corporates and also drivers, really pushed and boost the adoption of electric vehicle. So this is a real combination of plenty of factors will eventually make EV mainstream.
Okay, thank you, Shams. We will take a last question. Conscious of time, we are close to the end of our presentation. Don't we have a specific digital tool on which we pull the input and get an output for our recommendation?
Well, it's much more complex than this, unfortunately. You have also to keep in mind that we are in the real early beginning of this mobility shift. So we have been talking about mobility. It's true for many years, but imagine how many years we've been talking about EVs and it's becoming mainstream only now. So this is more or less where we stand today. So I think now the key priorities for mobility stakeholders is really to build on the experience with the shift of mobility. We are using digital tool in our approach. However, it still needs extremely big focus and expertise from our consultant to make sure you have the right recommendations for your mobility shift. So for now, no, it's not yet the time to have, let's say, on-demand mobility audit or online mobility audit with the recommendations. Okay. But it will come, I'm sure about it. I'm sure about it.
Perfect. So thank you.
Thank you, Yael. Thank you all for your active participation and also, let's say, the big interest you have shown towards this topic. We are extremely excited at Arval really to support our client with the mobility shift. As said previously, we will make available an executive summary. So it's not the deck itself or the presentation itself that will be available, but really a more detail with the real insights on the methodology, but also on the market trends to help you, better understand what we are trying to achieve. So you will receive a link in the course of the day, along with, of course, the replay of the session that we just had. So again, thank you, Yael, for your help and your insights on mobility. We hope to see you soon. This is something we will do for sure. We are passionate about talking about mobility, and we will have a similar event in the course of 2021. Thanks to you all, and have a great day. Bye.
Stay tuned. Bye bye.
And also, Happy New Year. I forgot. Happy New Year to you all. Bye bye.